music and prayer. Listen for God's voice in these readings. The first is found in Deuteronomy. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I'm commanding you to today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in God's ways, and observing God's commandments and decrees and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying God, and holding fast to God. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. To honor the risen Christ in our midst, we stand for this reading from the Gospel of Luke. Now large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, spouse and children, siblings, and yes, even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether you have enough to complete it? Otherwise, when you've laid a foundation and are not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule you, saying, 'This person began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God."
Thank you, Carrie. Whew, you gave me a hard gospel to talk about today. Well, dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Creator and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Merciful God, you call us to follow your commands and to love others as you have first loved us. Help us understand what it means to put you first in our life so that everything else we know and love will be honored by our words and our actions. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, it is good to be together with all of you on this Labor Day weekend. It's great to be gathered here together in God's house as we hear the word, as we celebrate in song and prayer, as we give thanks for all the blessings that God showers down upon us daily. It is a gift indeed to give thanks on this day. You know, on Labor Day, it's a special time for us to give thanks for all of the gifts that we have in our lives. Many of us do that by just getting away for a little bit, taking a little vacation, maybe that last trip of the summer before school and all the fall activities kick into full gear. And perhaps maybe some of you who are here today still have plans to do something like that, maybe just a little bit of time together with family or friends, perhaps a picnic or a lunch together or something else like that. And others might just be looking forward to a little bit of quiet time alone, some time away from work to relax, have an extra day off, and just do the things you want to do. Holidays are our chance to do that, to just step back a little bit, to take some time away. And sometimes Labor Day gives us a chance, like some of those holidays, to get together with people that we love the most. You know, I'm always grateful for any excuse that I can come up with to get together with my family. I love my family dearly. More than anything else in this world, I love my family, and I love being together with my family. And holiday times give us an opportunity to do that. Being together with the people I love, that is at the top of my list. And I suppose that's why reading something like Carrie just read for us a moment ago from the Gospels, When we hear words from Jesus, like the ones we just heard today, sometimes I find myself at a loss. Now, great multitudes accompanied Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate their own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even their own life, they cannot be my disciple." Hate the people that mean the most to me? Jesus said that? Well, I guess so, because it's right here in some of our Bibles in red letters, so Jesus must have said it, you know. Hate people, a directive to hate from Jesus, from the one that, well, we tell everybody, Jesus loves them, from the one who loves everyone unconditionally. Words of hate from Luke's gospel. Sometimes when we read words of Jesus in the Gospels, Jesus just doesn't sound like the Jesus that we have come to know and love, and this is one of those days. And oftentimes we pastors, when we come to readings like this one from today's Gospel, our first inclination is to try as hard as we can to get Jesus and God off the hook, you know? We feel as if it's our duty to paint a picture of God for you that is beautiful and peaceful, full of love and joy and all good things, so that you will never have to struggle with what it is that God is trying to say to you. But Jesus himself wasn't like that. It just wasn't the kind of preacher that Jesus was. Sometimes Jesus' words are hard to hear and understand, and they shake us to the very core. Words like the ones that we hear today. Oh, yes, Jesus' words are often filled with God's mercy and grace, but sometimes Jesus' words come to us like a bull in a china shop, knocking us off our feet, taking our breath away, and they leave us with an uneasy voice that asks, "What did he just say?" Jesus' words today leave us feeling a bit like that. At least they do me. What did he just say? Hate the people that I love the most? What do you mean, Jesus? What does hate have to do with your ministry and mission of love? I don't understand. It's really a strong word, hate. Webster's dictionary defines hate as an intense hostility and aversion towards, an extreme dislike or disgust for. This is how many of us understand the word hate. So what is it that Jesus is trying to tell us about our relationships with the people that we love the most when he uses the strong language of hate? Why do Jesus' words today sound so unlike Jesus? Well, first of all, it helps if we have a little more background on today's gospel reading. When it comes to understanding what Jesus is saying in Scripture, you know, you have to read the whole story of Jesus from the Gospels, plural. You have to remember where these stories came from, the historical context in which they were written, and who the people were who told these stories of Jesus' life. I mean, we have to remember things like, well, Jesus didn't dictate his words to somebody as he went about his ministry. The Gospels were first spoken, an oral tradition passed down for many years after Jesus ascended to heaven. And the Gospels weren't written down for many decades later, and there were many writers. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John from the Gospels of our Scriptures, they complement each other and uniquely each tell their own story of Jesus' life. And read together, their different perspectives help us better understand what each one of them is saying. And this is especially helpful for us to remember when it comes to parts of the Gospels, like this one we have before us today, where Jesus' words are so hard to understand. Again, let me share part of Jesus' words from Luke's gospel today. If anyone comes to me and does not hate their own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, they cannot be my disciple. Now let me share with you a gospel parallel from Matthew's gospel, chapters 10, verses 37, 38. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Both of these gospels tell the same story of a particular teaching of Jesus, but they use different words as they paint for us a picture of what Jesus is trying to say. Or do they? No, Matthew's gospel doesn't use the word hate when it comes to how we are to view our relationships with those we love the most, but Matthew's gospel does say that when it comes to our relationship with God, we are to put God first above all things in our life, even when it comes to loving others. We are to love God the most, even more than those who are closest to us. Now, this doesn't mean that we don't love them too. Rather, it means that we need to remember who gave them to us in the first place, our God of love and grace. Because of God's amazing love, we have these things. And our response should be to love God first and foremost over everything else in life, even more than those who mean everything to us, because without God, we wouldn't have any of these things in the first place, not even our own life. Jesus here is teaching us a lesson in Matthew's gospel of priorities. Priorities. So back to Luke's gospel. What is Luke talking about when he shares this same teaching of Jesus but uses the word hate in his story? Do Jesus' words in Luke's gospel have a different meaning, or is Luke really saying the same thing? Again, in order to understand the Gospels, we need to dig a little deeper each time we read them to understand this historical context of the time and the meaning of the language they used. That's another tool in understanding these stories. In the Aramaic language of Jesus' time, the word for hate could have several different meanings, one of which literally meant to love a great deal less than. To love a great deal less than. Jesus, too, in Luke's gospel could have been saying the same thing that Matthew's gospel said. Unless you love me a great deal more than anything or anyone else, you cannot be my disciple. You see, you can't just scratch the surface when you try to understand these stories from Scripture. You have to really get into them. You have to roll around in the dirt with what Jesus is saying, wrestle with what he's trying to teach you. You have to ask the questions and struggle over and over again with difficult words and read the whole story over and over again if you are to understand. Today's gospel takes this kind of wrestling with the story because, yes, Jesus' words today are harsh. They're strong words, and they are said to get our attention, not in a hateful way, but in a truthful, loving, beautiful, brutally honest way. To the crowds, Jesus said, if you want to follow me above everything else in your life, you have to put me first. If you really want to understand what it means to love those around you with all of your heart, first you have to love the one who has shown us what true love for one another really means. If you want to love yourself for who you are, warts and all, you have to look at yourself through the eyes of the one who looked at you from the cross and shed his own blood for you so that you would know just how special you really are in his eyes. If you want to obey the one who calls you to follow him, first you must realize the cost of following the one who gave all that he had to give so that you and all of creation might live again. Jesus is being brutally honest in Luke's gospel today. Following him will take us down many roads in life, and some of those roads will not be easy. With great love comes great cost. And this is the honest truth that Jesus was speaking to the crowds long ago and to us, the church, today. With these strong words from Luke's gospel, Jesus calls us to love him with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our strength, with all that we have to give. And when we put God first, we truly begin to understand what loving each other as God has first loved us is all about. It's not about hate as the world understands it. It's about loving the way God has shown us to love. Sometimes it does take strong words to get our attention. One time long ago, it took strong love to change the world and us forever. Thanks be to God for the strong love of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.